two paragraphs, just a few sentences, and we have at least four possibilities of topics presented for our consideration. Jesus was using some travel time to squeeze in a teaching opportunity that he wanted to share with just his inner circle of the 12 disciples. He was trying to tell them about his difficult future, his rapidly approaching arrest, crucifixion, and resurrection. But for those men who loved him enough to walk away from their lives and follow him, the lesson was just too difficult to comprehend. So they did what many students do, nothing. For fear of showing their ignorance, they kept their questions to themselves rather than seeking clarification. Instead, they did another thing that many people do, changed the subject. Instead of contemplating what the teacher meant by this strange lesson, they debated their own greatness. Because when we feel stupid or otherwise inadequate, we tend to demonstrate our stupidity by finding something about ourselves that we can boast or brag about. Like kids in a classroom, or children sneaking behind their parents' backs, the disciples thought they were having this discussion outside of Jesus' hearing. He didn't appear to be paying any attention as they each presented their case for why they were the greatest of the 12. However, like any good teacher or parent, Jesus was well aware of their squabble and confronted them when they returned to the house at the end of the day's journey. Their embarrassment silenced them. So while he had their undivided attention, Jesus claimed another teaching moment. This time, the lesson was crystal clear, sort of. If you want to be the greatest, you need to be the least. If you want to be the number one person at the top of the heap, you have to be a servant to everyone else. Obviously, Jesus had not attended the Donald Trump School of Leadership. We all know that to be the big cheese, you have to scratch and claw your way to the top, ruthlessly climbing over everyone else, squashing anyone who gets in your way. And once there, you get to lord your power over everyone, making all those around you serve you. What kind of nonsense was Jesus teaching now? First, some crazy stuff about rising from the dead, and now leading by serving? The disciples had endured a lifetime of being on the servant end of their society. The last thing they wanted was to be told they had to be servants to all. The last thing we want to hear is that we need to be servants to others. Our culture teaches us to continuously work to better ourselves, to elevate our position in life. The idea of the first being last and the last first sounds like more of that silly upside-down Jesus talk. Unless you take the time to watch the Jesus model of leadership in action, it sounds like nonsense. You can see that model, that first being last, the greatest being the servant of all, practiced whenever there's a major project undertaken here. We've just experienced an excellent example of the first being last on Friday night at our spaghetti dinner. This place was filled with smiling faces. The food was delicious, our guests were pleased, and our workers enjoyed themselves in spite of the sweat that was dripping down their foreheads in the steamy kitchen and in the steamy serving line upstairs. It was a smooth-running, happy evening. We had all ages of people working together, serving all ages of people. Everyone in Round Salem knows who to turn to whenever we have a meal to put on. We want Susan Heisler in charge of all things food, and we know that with her at the helm, we will have smooth sailing. There are several reasons for the success of our meals when Susan takes the leadership role. First of all, she's knowledgeable and skilled. After all, food service is her profession, and she has lots of experience feeding large numbers of people. Second, she's creative. So even when she's doing something that's been done before, she finds ways to improve the process or to change things up a bit to keep it fun. Third, she's organized. There is order in the midst of the work, and that makes it easier for all of us workers to find our own place in the process. And fourth, she is a servant leader. I've never heard Susan bark out orders. I've never seen her treat anyone as less than her. And I've never had to do damage control because she hurt somebody's feelings or disrespected them when they volunteered to work on a project that she was leading. Susan uses the Jesus model of leadership, and the result is people are willing to work hard because it's fun to work when we're rewarded with respect and with good results for our efforts. Lots of things around Salem get done with that same model of serving. Susan isn't our only servant leader. In fact, no matter who is in charge, it is this model of leading by serving that gets used. When there's a cleaning day, nobody stands on a platform with a bullhorn and a whip. People may suggest a project or may give some advice on a good way to accomplish something, but nobody is made to feel like the lowly grunt of the dirtiest, nastiest, rottenest job. Everyone has a voice and is free to use it to offer suggestions. The spirit of cooperation that has been nurtured in this congregation is a wonderful thing to witness. Salem knows how to function together. But there's always room for growth. And that brings us to the last two sentences in our reading. After Jesus told his disciples that they needed to be servants of all if they want to be great, he did something very peculiar in that society. He picked up a child onto his lap and said, "Whoever welcomes a child in my name welcomes me and the one who sent me." If you think talking about being arrested, crucified, killed, and rising from the dead was a strange topic, or if you think that raising up being a servant leader in a culture filled with slave-master relationships, if you think that was a strange thing to say, welcoming a child was the most strange thing of all. Children were nothing until they were big enough to contribute to the workload of the family. They were a burden. They were less valuable than women, and women were less valuable than livestock. Yet in the eyes of Jesus, they were precious treasures that needed to be welcomed, cared for, and nurtured. It's important when we read scripture to put things into historical social context. In our society, we see a toddler waddling around and we all smile. We want to pick up that precious little one, maybe even compete over who gets to hold the cutie, give them a hug, cuddle them, read to them, play learning games with them like peekaboo and counting their toys and singing the alphabet song. But in that society, life was too strenuous to have time to play with a child. Everything about life was demanding and difficult. Nobody had the luxury of time or energy for kids. Children were an in-the-way nuisance. For this scripture to impact us the way it impacted the disciples, we need to think about who our society is very comfortable neglecting. Who is it that we can easily walk past without really seeing them? Who is it that gets in the way of us efficiently going about our lives? Who is it that makes us feel grumbly when we're distracted by their presence? When we figure out who it is Jesus is calling us to welcome, then we as individuals and we as the church can take the next step from being really good at being the church toward each other to more engaged in being the church in our society. I can think of a few groups who might be our modern day equivalent of first century children, our elderly and disabled, the growing number of children and adults with ADD, ADHD, and on the autism spectrum. People who English is not their first language. People with other kinds of learning disabilities. People in chronic pain. Or those who suffer from depression. The poor. People new in our community. Outsiders who don't know the school system, where to get a key copy, who has the best coffee, or where to go to meet new friends. These and others who feel marginalized are the people Jesus is calling us to reach out to and embrace. The challenge in his simple act of picking up a child and placing that little one on his lap is, who will we embrace? Looking again at the spaghetti dinner, we created an atmosphere that invited our community in, not just for food, but for camaraderie. We provided a service to all of those who ate here that went beyond filling their stomachs. We gave them a place to meet family and friends for conversation and laughter. That is as important as nutrition. We were a safe place for people on the entire social spectrum to gather. For a few hours, college students, retirees, little kids, and all ages in between sat at tables together talking and laughing. Rich and poor shared conversations about rice pudding and peach pie and chocolate cake. Lifelong Albion residents and newcomers talked and got to know each other a bit. We also used that dinner to show our appreciation to first responders. And whether they came to dinner or not, they found out something important. We appreciate them. Being invited told them we honor their work. We reached out our hands of friendship to all the people that we invited, regardless of whether they were able to attend. Some purchased meal tickets for others, and some stayed and sat a bit longer to keep company with somebody else who arrived after them. What was on the surface a fundraising event for the church was successful not just because we made money, but because we made a community. We created a place for people to connect, no matter who they are or where they are on life's journey. We need to find more opportunities to reach out to our community, more ways to be the arms of Jesus. I invite us to continue the conversations. Who do you see as the metaphorical child we need to welcome in the name of Jesus? And how do you envision doing that? We are a church with lots and lots and lots of love to give away. What will we do next to give that love to people outside this beautiful building? And we'll be joyful servants. May our welcome be as extravagant as the one we all receive from our loving God. May we be the church by reaching outside our building and into our community. Amen.